that song, right? That was unbelievable. Can we give it up? So many of you guys may not know this. Kelsey is a choir teacher at Noblesville High School, and Mackenzie is one of her students. And so we were thinking about this series, thinking about relationships and how relationships can be so complicated, and sometimes you just got to take a deep breath. And somebody came up with this idea of this song. Kelsey's like, I know a girl, one of my students, that can just crush this song, which she absolutely did. So I'm so grateful that Mackenzie's here with us today. Grateful that you're here. My name's Justin. I'm one of the pastors here at Hope City. And if you're a guest with us today, we just did Ariana Grande in church. So boom, all right? So some of you are like, who's Ariana Grande? You can figure that out after the service. And so anyway, but if you are a guest, one of the things we say around here all the time is Hope City is a place where you can belong before you believe. And so no matter where you are spiritually in your relationship with God, man, we just hope that you feel at home, feel welcome. And if you don't, you're going to have cotton candy after the service, so that'll help, okay? So enjoy that as you leave. We thought, this looks like cotton candy, and so we just wanted to serve it as you leave today as we conclude the series. You know, one of the things that you kind of realize as we go on, and you know, in church, we're a little over 2 years old, and I have conversations that remind me that I take some things for granted just because I'm kind of so close to it. And I was talking to someone after first service last week, and they were talking about message notes and how we have different blanks up on the screen and different, you know, statements up on the screen. And I don't know that I necessarily do a good job of explaining. If you are interested in taking notes, on the back of that program, there is an area that just says message notes, and you can write, I mean, you can write a letter, you can play tic-tac-toe, you can do anything on there, but there is a place for message notes, but there's a bigger place for notes. My entire outline, anybody who communicates, their entire outline is on our app. And so if you download the Hope City Church app, you search Hope City Church, comma, Indianapolis in the App Store or the Google Play Store, and then on the menu button, you can scroll down and you'll see message notes and this week's message notes outline, basically, hopefully, word for word, okay? Unless I skip something, which I've done before, and people come up with, hey, you skipped something. But it's all on there, and love to have you, you know, follow along. If that's your jam, if you don't like taking notes, then just chill, all right? You don't have to, but I just wanted you to know that because I kind of take that information for granted because I'm in it every single week. So, well, we've been in this series called It's Not You, It's Me, talking about relationships over the last few weeks. And so this week, we wanted to have some fun between Sundays. And so if you follow us on Instagram, maybe you participated in this poll that we did. We did a poll on Wednesday and Thursday of this last week that just ran for 24 hours asking you guys who follow us on Instagram, Hope City Indy, some relationship questions. And so we're going to look at some questions and then the poll results of those questions. So first thing, would you rather go on a date and dress up and be fancy? So go out on a date and be fancy, or stay at home on a date and be comfortable? What do you guys think the answers were? I'm going to say comfortable is one. Oh, yeah, there we go. 63% to 37%, all right? Which just means we probably have a lot of secure people in relationships, all right? Like, there's not a lot of people trying to impress anybody who voted. All right, next one. Would you rather have a conversation via text message or have a conversation via a phone call? If you're here a couple weeks ago, Trisha asked this question. We thought we would put it out onto Instagram and get some answers. Whoa, that is a lot closer than I thought. I cannot believe call. I'm thinking 50 people who are 50 and over answered this. All right, I don't know. For those of you that call me and leave me voicemails, you know this. I don't like talking on the phone, and so texting is my jam. So anyway, sorry about that. So 50, that was interesting. All right, I learned something about whoever answered these. I need to go back and look. Okay, actually, you can't. It's over. But okay, would you rather be snowed in for a week with your family, or be snowed in with a week with your in-laws, okay? This could cause some issues, all right? Thankfully, this is only our creative arts director, Sarah, knows who voted on these, okay? So let's see what we got here. Whoa! No love for in-laws on this poll, all right? I would just say neither, okay? But that's not an option. I would not want to be snowed in with either one. Okay, would you rather have a roommate that's awkwardly introverted, or have a roommate that doesn't give you personal space? I should say space. There's just space there underneath there, so you can, okay? Whoa, introverted, all right? So some of you just don't want to talk to anybody, and it would be better to not have any conversation at all than have way more conversation than you wanted, okay? Is there one more? Is that it? Okay, last one. Would you rather date someone who cooks all the time, but their food is terrible? This was not about my wife, okay? So just so you know, or date somebody that doesn't cook at all. What do you think the answer is? Wow, terrible cook, 12% doesn't cook, 88%, all right? That's why there's so many restaurants in Carmel, right? Because we all would rather just go out to eat rather than have bad food at home. All right, so hopefully those are fun. And just as we wrap up the series, now you have some new things to talk about on your way home. If the message doesn't, if the message bombs, you know that you have some would you rather questions that you could ask on the way home. So, you know, here's why this series has been important over the last 4 weeks, last 3 weeks, is the quality of our life is ultimately, not ultimately, but in large part is determined by the quality of our relationships. The healthier relationships are, my guess is the happier your life is, right? And so when we get sideways in relationships, even if we're trying to connect with God, even if we are, you know, in a growing relationship with God, if we're sideways with the people that we relate to, it doesn't allow us to experience the ultimate joy and the ultimate, you know, the ultimate freedom that we long for in the context of our life. And so the reason that we take some time out every February to talk about relationships is the quality of our life is determined by the health of our relationships. And so often what happens is we say, well, my relationship is dysfunctional, and that means you have a problem. And so we say, hey, what if we take 4 weeks and we talk about, no, maybe I have a problem. So the first week, if you weren't here, we talked about expectations and how so often we place God-sized expectations on the people that we're in relationships with, and we expect them to come through in ways that they're not even created to do. And so we say it's not me, it's you, but it's really us, because it's our expectations are either unrealistic or they're just way too complicated. And then the next week we talked about communication and how oftentimes we take communication and relationships for granted, and then we don't understand why we're not connecting with the people that we love most, our friends, our boss, co-workers, our spouse. And then last week we talked about insecurity and how it's not me, it's my insecurity. And when we feel insecure in a relationship, we begin to project negative things into that relationship, and it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? Things that aren't even wrong in a relationship because of our own insecurity create problems in relationships. And we said, hey, if you want to experience the fullness of all the relationship joy that you are created to experience, you're going to have to identify that you're insecure. You're going to have to admit that, hey, I need to find my security in my relationship with God first and then look to people second. And that's how a natural and a healthy flow of relationship takes place. Well, today, I want to talk to you about something that I think complicates more relationships than we are even aware of. And I want to talk to you about, hey, it's not you, it's my past. Because I think that what prevents most of us from experiencing the fullness of joy and the fullness of God's plan for our future is our unforgettable past. And we carry our past into all of our relationships, good and bad. But without dealing with our past, then our past then becomes a driving force in the health of our relationships. And so we're going to talk about how we can address our past and really find some freedom from it. I was arrested when I was in high school. That was on my job application when I decided to start the church. Let me explain, though. It wasn't really that bad. But so my senior year of high school, I played on the basketball team, and we had a huge game against Western Boone, which doesn't sound huge now because they're not necessarily that good now, but they were phenomenal when I my senior year of high school. And a guy that I could not stand played for Western Boone, so it was a big game. I had seventh period study hall, and so most Fridays that we would have a game, I would kind of skip out on study hall, leave school early, and a guy on my team, his mom was the school secretary, and so we kind of organized this. He was on my study hall too, and so he and I and a couple other friends, we left school, and we're just going to go home to my house to hang out for a few hours before we had to come back for the shoot around before the game that night. And so we're leaving school, and I'm driving, and I have a 1978 Datsun B210, all right? And before you think, wow, that's really impressive, it was $750, and my parents paid half of it, I paid the other half, and so it was as bad as it sounds, okay? 1978 Datsun, pretty piece of junk car, but it was in good condition, didn't have any dents, didn't have any mechanical issues, it just wasn't very attractive, and it was pretty old. And so we pile all into my Datsun, and we're heading home, and I want to avoid a stoplight, and there's some traffic that's backed up, and it's snowing, it's kind of slushy out, and so I decide to cut down this alley on the way to my house. Well, I make a left turn to go through this alley, and my car does not turn, and I start sliding on some black ice, and I slide right into the side, a brick wall, of a warehouse company that was in Crawfordsville. And I get out, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I just jacked up my car, and all my buddies are making fun of me, and ha, 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 you know, and they're laughing, and I'm just thinking, my dad is going to kill me. That's all I could think. And there's, you know, my headlights busted out. There's a big old scrape down the side of my car. And so I back away. My car's still running. There's no smoke going anywhere or anything like that. I back away, and I noticed that the only damage to this brick wall is there's a blue, my car was blue, there's this blue strip of paint that just goes down the side of the wall. And my buddy's like, hey, there's no damage, we can just go. And so I jump back in the car, and we go to my house, and I think to myself, I don't want to deal with this on game night, so I'm just going to park the car in my garage, and I'll deal with my dad later. So I park the car in the garage, I shut the door, we go hang out for a few hours, we have another buddy of ours come and pick us up and take us back to the game. So the JV plays before the varsity. I'm out there shooting around. The varsity's out shooting around before the JV game. And all of a sudden, a friend of mine who's on the team, his dad was a police officer, he walks into the gym, which was not abnormal. And he walks right onto the court, and he says, Justin, I've got some bad news for you. And I said, what's that? He's like, you're not going to be able to play tonight. I said, why? He's like, you're being arrested for hit and run. I'm like, what? And I'm so grateful there was not social media, because like, there was, I didn't know how many people, there was not very many people in the gym. It felt like there was 300 people just watching this. He puts my hands, I'm in my shorts, a t-shirt, and my basketball shoes, puts my hands behind my back, handcuffs me, and takes me out of the gym, puts me in the back of a squad car. My friends were laughing. They were not as empathetic with me. I'm freaking out. So we go downtown to the police station. He takes me back into this interrogation room. We sit there for the majority of the JV game. And he's just talking to me about hit and run, talking to me about the implications of having an accident, talking to me about why I hid my car in my garage. I'm like, well, I wasn't trying to get away with anything with you. I just didn't want my dad to know. I was just hiding it from him. He's like, well, that is, I don't know what he said, class B, felony, class C, something. You know, he starts naming off all of these things. He's like, you could go to jail. He's like, you're 17 years old. You can be tried as an adult. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have a record, right? And so this goes on and on and on. I don't know, it was maybe 20 minutes, but it felt like 2.5 hours, right? And I had the light on me. I'm sweating. And he's like, are you scared right now? I said, yes. He's like, are you ever going to hit and leave a scene of an accident again? I said, no. He's like, well, you can thank your dad. He's like, I was just going to talk to you after the game, but your dad told me to arrest you. So I walk out of the police station in my shorts and t-shirt, and my dad's sitting in his little minivan. Hey. And I'm not going to tell you the sign language I gave him as I walked back to the school. Like, it was like 4 blocks away. I'm like, I'm not right with it. I didn't talk to him for a few days. But I tell you that story because I think that's how some of us deal with our past. I think that's how many of us are conditioned to deal with the bad things that happen in our life. We have these moments in our life that we experience a crash. We make a mistake, make a decision that we regret. Maybe it's a sin that we commit or a sin that's committed against us. Maybe it's abuse that we experience. Maybe it's abandonment that we've experienced. Maybe it's a loss of a relationship. Maybe it's a tragedy. We all have these things in our life, these walls that we hit that cause damage to our hearts. And for many of us, what we do is we pull our life into the garage, we shut the door behind us, and we hope it goes away. We hope it just gets better over time. And one of the things I put in your notes, first thing I put in your notes is our past is a product of two things. What we have done and what has been done to us. And so as we talk about our past today, both good and bad things, right, make up your past. There are good experiences that you had as a kid. There's bad experiences that you had as a kid. There's good experiences that you had as a teenager. There's bad choices that you made as a teenager. There's good things that you did in college. There's things that you never want to talk about again that you did in college, right? And so all of those things make up our past. What I want to specifically talk about today, not because the good isn't good, but because we can move on from the good. It doesn't necessarily affect us as much as the bad. And so as we talk about the past, I'm talking about the bad things that we have done or the bad things that have been done to us that we now carry into all of our relationships. You see, our past will influence us, but it doesn't have to define us. Your past, you can't escape it. It's a part of you. The experiences that you've had, the choices that you've made, the mistakes that you've made, the things that you wish you could take back, all the regret that you live with, you can't escape that. It will influence you, but it does not have to define you. It can inform you. It does not have to define who you become. And that's really something that we've been learning over the last 18 months as we've been navigating the adoption of our two youngest kids. And many of you guys know that they were not 8 and 10 when we adopted them, and they're unbelievable kids. I mean, they light up the room with their smile. Jalen has this dimple that's just, just so irresistible. Janiyah has a personality. I mean, she literally gets up in the morning and does cartwheels to the bathroom. Like, that, she's just full of joy. But they also have a past. And when you adopt older children, I don't think that we took into consideration some of the things that they would have experienced that affect who they are right now. And so we've navigated abandonment. We've navigated homelessness. We've navigated foster care. We've navigated all of these things that they've experienced and all of these things that still inform who they are today. Their past is filled with hurt and heartache. It's filled with abuse and neglect. It's filled with poverty and uncertainty. And one of the things that we want them to know is just because you experienced those things, we can't take those things away. Even a relationship with God can bring healing, but doesn't erase the past. But they don't have to be defined by it. They don't have to choose that path just because they may have experienced that in their past. And I would say the same is true with you today. It will influence us, but it does not have to define us. And really the biggest roadblock, I think, to us experiencing the relationships that we deeply desire is our unwillingness to identify, acknowledge, and deal with some of the things that we have experienced in our past. And so what happens is we just take it into the next relationship, into the next job, into the next marriage, into the next conversation, into the next thing, and we never really find freedom from it because we're always running from it. In the Old Testament, I tried this week to put this scripture together to share with you guys. It goes over four chapters in the book of Genesis. So I'm not going to do that, all right? So some of you are like, what? I'm not going to do that. But I am going to tell you the story, and we're going to try to make application as we go. And the story in the book of Genesis in the Old Testament, it's the account of really two pillars of this new community that God created, the nation of Israel. And there are two brothers that are born to Isaac, which is the son of Abraham. So it's Abraham is kind of the father of the nation of Israel. He has a son named Isaac. And then Isaac has two sons, Jacob and Esau. And Jacob and Esau really become the foundational pieces to the story that's written all throughout the Old Testament. And these brothers, some of you that have siblings, you know this can be true. These brothers were born from the same mom and dad, but they were completely different. They were different in personality. They were different in appearance. They were different in every way. Jacob was handsome. Jacob was kind. Jacob was kind of a mama's boy. Jacob was his mom's favorite. Jacob didn't go hunting. He didn't shoot, kill wild game. He didn't, cook wild game. He just kind of hung out with the women and children while all the guys went out hunting. All the guys went out and tried to, kill some food to bring it back to eat. Esau was an outdoorsman. Esau was the farthest thing from a mama's boy. He loved to be out in the woods. He loved to be out hunting. He loved to be out adventuring. He was hairy, very hairy, the Bible says. I don't know why it describes him that way, but he's a very hairy person. He's a very brute person. He's not exactly an attractive person. He's a very rough personality. And Jacob was Isaac's favorite. And so there's this dynamic that takes place in their relationship really from the very beginning where they're kind of opposed to one another. And all throughout the Bible, and even as we have a conversation about today, Jacob is always mentioned first. Jacob and Esau, Jacob and Esau. Not always, but most of the time in conversation, Jacob and Esau. But Esau was actually the older brother. Jacob was the younger brother. And this had huge implications, not just in their family, but in their relationship. And so they're born, they are in the same family, but they are completely different. And in this culture, being the oldest meant two things. First, it meant that you had what was called a birthright. And in Jewish culture, a birthright was a very serious thing. It was not to be negotiated. It was not to be tampered with. It was something that was handed down from generation to generation. If you were the oldest son, you were given this birthright, which meant that you had the right to the majority of the property, the majority of the inheritance, the majority of the parents' blessing. You had the right to carry on the family business, and other siblings would have to work for you. So the oldest, and being the oldest, carried this not only this huge responsibility, but this huge honor. The second thing that being the oldest, at least in this family, dictated was that you also had what was called a blessing. So there was a blessing, or there was a birthright, and there was a blessing. And the blessing was basically speaking into existence God's favor into your life. Okay, so Abraham did that to Isaac, and Abraham passed on God's favor, and this mantle of leading the nation of Israel and being the father of the nation of Israel was passed on to Isaac, and Isaac was going to pass this blessing on to his oldest son. That was the plan. That was how it was supposed to work. Well, the Bible says that, you know, Jacob is his mom's favorite, Esau is his dad's favorite. So one day Esau is out hunting, and he's going to go out and kill some food, bring it back, and he's going to prepare it for his dad. And he gets really hungry. And so he comes into the house, and he is just starving. And he's kind of out of his mind. And Jacob is sitting there because he's been hanging out with the women and children, and so he's eating some lentil stew that he just whipped up. And so Esau comes in, he's like, oh my gosh, give me some of that lentil stew. Jacob's like, no, this is my lentil stew. He's like, no, I am starving. You don't realize how hungry I am. I need some of that lentil stew. And Jacob's like, well, give me your birthright. You give me your birthright, I'll give you some lentil stew. And for us sitting here today, you're like, that's such a stupid thing. A bowl of soup for a birthright? Who would do that? Have you ever done 90 days same as cash? You ever been walking through the airport and apply for a credit card? Like, we do some stupid things, right? Like, don't judge Esau just because he was starving and who knew how many days he had left without eating, right? But he cannot get this lentil stew out of his mind. And so he agrees. He says, okay, you can have my birthright. And they shake on it. They make a deal on it. And there's no going back. Like, this isn't like, hey, I had my fingers crossed. Like, this is in this culture, your word was your bond. I know that's a foreign concept, but your word was your bond. And so they make this deal, and that's it. It's over. And so from the very beginning of their relationship, you see this propensity that Jacob has to manipulate people and to control situations and to take advantage of people. It's a part of his story. It's a part of how he's wired. And so another day, Esau's out hunting, and Rebekah is Jacob and Esau's mom, and she comes to Jacob, who is her favorite, and she says, hey, your father's getting ready to pass away. He's going to give his blessing to somebody, and that somebody is Esau. And you and I both know Esau is not fit to lead the nation of Israel. Esau should not have your father's blessing. You should have your father's blessing. And he's kind of, you know, his eyesight's going away. He's getting older. He's just a few days or weeks away from passing. I think that we have an opportunity here while your brother's out hunting to get your father's blessing that he was going to give to Esau. And Jacob's like, how are we going to do that? She's like, well, I've killed this animal. I want you to put the skin of this animal on your arms. You're going to go in. You're going to take this game, this wild game that I have prepared for your father. You're going to take it. It's just like Esau would have prepared it. He's going to hear your voice. He's going to think it's Jacob, but then he's going to feel your arms and he's going to know it's Esau. Then he's going to taste the food, and that's going to confirm that it's not Jacob, it's actually Esau. Which begs the question, how hairy were Esau's arms, right? Like, if you had to kill an animal and put it on there, I don't know the answer. We'll ask that in heaven. I don't know the answer to that, but that's what it says, all right? And so this whole thing, so Jacob goes along with Rebekah's plan. So you see this mom who's deceitful. She passes that deceit down into the life of her son, who already has a propensity to manipulate, already has a propensity and a predisposition to take advantage of people. And they pull off this heist. They pull off the heist of this blessing. Now you could say, well, that's not really that big a deal. No, it was an oath. Like in the Old Testament, it was like serious business. It wasn't something to be negotiated. Once Jacob received Esau's blessing, Isaac couldn't say, well, I got to take that back. And so Jacob receives Isaac's blessing. He leaves the tent. Sometime later, Esau comes in and he has prepared a meal for his dad. And Isaac's like, whoa. We already had this conversation. What are you doing? And they realize that they have both been deceived. And so Esau has been manipulated out of his blessing, or his birthright, and he's been deceived out of his blessing. And he vows in that moment, I am going to kill my brother Jacob. And he's not just talking in hyperbole. He's serious. He is going to hunt him down and kill him. And so Rebekah here overhears this conversation, because that's the only way for Esau to get the birthright back and to get the blessing back, was for Jacob to be killed. So Rebekah hears this conversation, and she goes to Jacob and says, hey, you got to get out of here. Go to my brother's house. He'll be a safe place for you to stay. And so Jacob leaves, and he goes and stays with his uncle, whose name is Laban. And so he gets to his uncle's house, and he notices this really attractive lady that he wants to be in a relationship with, and it's his cousin, Rachel. And so he goes to Laban and says, oh my gosh, your daughter is beautiful. I want to be in a relationship with her. And Laban says, hey, you work for me for 7 years and you can marry her. So Jacob, who deceived somebody out of their birthright for lentil stew, sees no issue with working for 7 years for somebody to marry their daughter. And so he agrees to do it. Again, your word is your bond. And the Bible says something interesting about Rachel. She has another sister. Rachel's actually the younger sister. Leah is her older sister. And the Bible says that Leah, there was no sparkle in Leah's eyes. That's how they describe her. But Rachel had an amazing figure and a pretty face. It's good they look at the character in the Old Testament of a person, but that's how they're described. So basically the translation is Leah's not that attractive. Rachel is drop-dead gorgeous. And so 7 years go by. Jacob goes to Laban and says, hey, I fulfilled my covenant with you. I fulfilled my promise. I've worked for you for 7 years. Tonight is the night. I want to marry your daughter. And so after it gets dark, Laban sends his oldest daughter, Leah, into the tent. Jacob sleeps with Leah, wakes up the next morning realizing that it's not Rachel, which begs the question, how dark was that tent, right? Like, oh my gosh, right? But that's what happens. And so Jacob then goes back to Laban and says, you've deceived me. Now the deceiver has been deceived. You know, the name Jacob actually means deceiver. And so this pattern of deception starts with Jacob and his manipulation of the birthright. It flows into Rachel or Rebecca and her convincing Jacob to be deceitful to his brother and his father. And now Jacob has been deceived by his uncle. And so Laban says, you know what? My bad. Sorry. But you're stuck with her. If you want Rachel, you can marry her too. It's another 7 years. Jacob agrees to do it. So he works for another 7 years. At the end of that 7 years, Laban is not really willing to follow through, but Jacob says, hey, we had an oath, and so Laban goes ahead and lets Jacob marry his youngest daughter, Rachel. And he works there with Laban for a few more years, but God's blessing, remember, it was passed on to Jacob. And so God starts blessing Jacob in tremendous ways. And he becomes very wealthy. He becomes more successful than Laban, and Laban gets jealous of him, and he starts hunting him down to kill him. He wants to kill Jacob. And so Jacob decides, I'm going to go home. The problem with that is, in order to go home, he has to pass through a territory with all of his livestock and all of his belongings and this caravan of people. He has 11 kids and two wives. It's not just like jumping in the minivan and driving, you know, to wherever your hometown is. There's a lot of process here to going home for Jacob. And he has to pass through the territory where his brother lives. It's been 20 years since he's seen or talked to his brother. And so he has this belief that I'm going to be killed by my brother, but I cannot get home without encountering him. And so Jacob puts together like this care package. He puts together all of these gifts and all this stuff, his livestock and money and all these family heirlooms, and he sends them ahead with messengers to meet and to negotiate with Esau as a peace offering. Please just let my family pass through your territory without harming us. So the messengers come back after delivering all this stuff, and they say, hey, Esau's on his way to meet you, and he has 400 soldiers. And Jacob's like, oh boy, right? Like Jacob just knows he is going to die. And so he decides he's going to split his family up and send them in different directions so that Esau doesn't know who he's related to try to spare the life of his family. Jacob and Esau have this encounter in Genesis chapter 33. It says this, then after 20 years, Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they both wept. So there's this deceiver who has deceived his father, deceived his brother, now has been deceived by his uncle. It's a part of his history. It's a part of his past. And for the last 20 years, he has ran from it. He's run from it. He's avoided it. He's tried to pretend it didn't exist. The problem is he could not escape deception. Once he had that as a part of his story, he just kept repeating it over and over again in different forms, in different ways. Jacob was either deceitful or he was being deceived. But here he has this encounter with his brother, and it was his willingness to face his past that actually unlocked his past from affecting the rest of his future. There's this moment of repentance. There's this moment where Esau says, hey, why did you bring me all this stuff? And Jacob's like, I thought you were going to kill me. He's like, no, you can take all your stuff back. I love you. I want to be in a relationship with you. And Jacob's like, no, keep the stuff. I think I've caused you enough pain. But there's this ownership of Jacob's past that actually set him free to live a different story moving forward. And here's what I put in your notes. If we don't transform our past, we are set up to repeat it. If you don't allow your past to be transformed by the person of Jesus Christ, you are inevitably probably going to repeat your past. I want you to think about your life. Think about your relationships. My guess is you can see a pattern in your life. Maybe something that you've ignored. Maybe it's something that you don't want to deal with. Maybe it's something that you thought was not a big deal. But it's affected pretty much every single relationship you've ever been in. Your first girlfriend or first boyfriend, your parents, your siblings, the person that you're in a relationship with now, maybe your coworkers, maybe your boss, they all point out this one thing about you. And it's something that happened in the past that just continues to follow you. And what you think is, I'm going to get a fresh start if I just go to a different relationship. I'm going to get a fresh start if I can just, move to a different job. And so we replace the people in our life trying to escape the things that we have chosen in our past. But without allowing God to transform it, we're just going to repeat it. One of the things I realize most of the time is that the things that we struggle with, whether that be sexual addiction or lying or short tempers or control issues, we don't just acquire those things out of nowhere, right? Those things are products of things that have happened to us or choices that we have made. And most of the time, just like in Jacob's family, they're passed down from generation to generation. So my guess is, if you can think of some of the most dysfunctional things about you, you're not the only one in your family that struggles with it. Maybe for some of you it's a temper. Maybe for some of you it's insecurity. Maybe for some of you it's anxiety. Maybe for some of you, it doesn't have to be these big sinful things, right? But there's been a history in your family of this because nobody's really taken the time to go, wait, why do I struggle with that? What's going on that I keep repeating the same things over and over again? Let me give you a couple examples. First example is, do you know that a person who is born to a teenage mom is 200 times more likely to have a child as a teenager? Right? Why is that? It's just this continuation of generational choices. And this is why the divorce rate for second marriages is 75%. Why? Because people who got divorced are bad people? No, not they're probably great people. Why? Is it because they're not in love? No, they're in love. Most of the time what happens is people who've experienced the loss of a relationship or the disintegration of a marriage, they find love again, but they don't take time to do the internal work of fixing the wounds that the divorce caused, and so they bring those wounds into the next relationship. And they already have the history of divorce, and so they think, it's not worth it. I'm not going to go through this for 15 years like I did before. I'm only going to go through this for 3 years or 15 months, right? And so there's the higher divorce rate, not because people who get divorced and remarried are bad people, because we haven't taken care of the things in our past, and we tend to repeat them. And so it takes monumental transformation. And so I've got just a few minutes left. I want to share with you really quickly this passage and then some application in Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, and then verse 16. It says, this is Paul talking. He said, I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things, or that I've already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I've not achieved it all, but I focus on one thing. Here's the key. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Jesus Christ, has calling us. And here's the first application point. Our willingness to be honest about our past will determine our ability to move on from it. Your willingness to identify the things in your past that are holding you back will determine your ability to move on from it. And we've talked about this before at Hope City. If you're a first-time guest here, then this will be new information and maybe a little shocking to you, but for the first 10 years of my marriage and ministry, I had a lot of sexual brokenness that I carried with me into relationships, into ministry, into my marriage. I was sexually abused when I was a kid, never got any help for it. I struggled with pornography for 10 years, never talked about it, never admitted it, never got any help for it. And one of the things that my counselor told me, he said, hey, you can't heal a wound that you're unwilling to give a name to. And that was freeing for me. Because it wasn't a label that I was given. It was identifying what is it about me that is broken so then I can allow God to fix it. All right. So here's the next point is identify when that part of you was broken. If you're going to move on from your past, you got to identify when that part of you is broken. And so often we repeat sins and behavior patterns in our life because we fail to understand when we first experience brokenness. We talked about insecurity last week. If you weren't here, you can go back and watch it online. But I struggled with insecurity for so long in my life, and I just thought, well, I just need to be more secure, right? And so how I dealt with that was I would pretend to be better than I really was, and so it came across as pride. Well, when I was trying to find healing for that in my area, I had to go back to a point. I got cut from the basketball team in eighth grade, and I made a determination in my mind at that point, no one is ever going to tell me I'm not good enough again. And so even if I'm not good enough, I'm going to pretend I am good enough, right? And so just identifying that point in the past helped me find freedom and healing moving forward. Forgiveness of sin isn't the same as healing from sin, right? When you acknowledge something that you've done in your past that's wrong and you ask God to forgive you, immediately he forgives. It's instantaneous. As far as east is from the west, God removes our sin from us. But healing takes time, and healing takes work, and healing takes you participating. You can't participate in your own forgiveness other than confession, right? You don't have the ability to forgive sin. God does that free. That's what grace is all about. But healing takes work, and it's you participating in that with God to find freedom from your past. Secondly, be honest about your brokenness to God and to another person. Being known by God will allow you to experience grace. Being known by someone else will allow you to experience healing. That's why James 5:17 says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you might be healed. There's something cathartic about community, being able to be real and honest with the people that are in our life. Next, move from avoiding sin to pursuing God. For so long, the church has been about what you can't do, right? Just, hey, if you're going to be a Christian, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this. Does that help anybody find transformation? I don't think so. If you said to me, hey, or if you came in and said, Justin, how can I fall more in love with my husband? And I say to you, well, you can't do this, and you can't do this, and you can't do this, and you can't do this. Like, what's that about? How do you fall more in love with a person? You pursue them, right? You make time for them. You prioritize them. You dive deeper into a relationship with them. That's why most married couples, when they fall out of love, you know why they fall out of love? Because they stop doing the things that caused them to fall in love in the first place. Right? And so God doesn't want you just to avoid sin. God wants you to pursue him. Avoiding sin never helped anybody love God more. But loving God more will help you avoid sin, because you'll be so much more in love with God that the things that aren't of God won't even be attractive to you. You'll be able to recognize them easier. And so don't make your life about avoiding. Now, the Bible does say, you know, flee from temptation, flee from the enemy. I know that. But if you're going to orient your entire Christian walk about just avoiding sin, then you're going to rob yourself of a full experience of God's grace and experience him in fuller ways. And finally, focus on progress, not perfection. Look how Paul ends this in verse 16. He says, but we must hold on to the progress we have already made. What if you stopped thinking about how far you have to go in your relationships and started thinking about how far you've come? How freeing would that be? What if you stopped beating yourself up for the mom that you're not and started looking back at all the ways that you are a great mom? What if you stopped thinking about how far you have to go in your relationship with God and look back at how far God has brought you? You're not who you want to be, but you're not who you used to be either. My guess is, if you're in a relationship with God, he transforms us a little at a time. And so often I think we get so distracted and so beat down by just, oh my gosh, they're so much more put together than me. Oh my gosh, I don't have it together. Oh my gosh, I made that mistake again. And God's saying, hey, Paul says this in verse 16, remember the progress that you've already made. We were on our way to the sectional championship last night. Our freshman in high school, he plays for Zionsville, sectional champs. We're on their way, and he dresses varsity as a freshman, which if you told me before the season started that he was going to dress varsity as a freshman, I'd be like, that is amazing. But he's dressed varsity pretty much every game this season except for a few. And the longer the season has gone on, the more judgmental I've got of the coach. Like, hey, we're up 17 with 2 minutes left. Why is he not in? Hey, we're up 21 with 5 minutes left. Why is he not in? And so rather than looking at the gift of actually being on varsity as a freshman, which is in the state of Indiana, is a pretty nice accomplishment, I've been like, he needs more playing time. I don't understand what the coach is doing, right? And so we're on our way. We land at the airport at 6:08. The game starts at 7:30 in Kokomo. So I'm not even going to tell you how fast I'm driving to get there. And I just have this intensity. We were doing a marriage conference in Atlanta. We land, we drive to Kokomo last night, and we get about halfway there, and Trisha said, you know what? You're going to be much more happy, and so will I, if you just focus on the gift that he has sitting on the bench, right? Don't focus on all that he's not. Focus on what he's done. Like, what that he gets to sit on there. He's probably going to win a sectional championship tonight. And for the most part, I did. Okay, I'm just going to tell you, I celebrated that, right? But maybe that's what God is saying to you. Maybe God's going to help you overcome your past, not by beating yourself up for your past, but by focusing on how far he has brought you, to give you motivation to continue the journey he has in mind. See, you cannot change your past, but Jesus can change your future. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. New life has come. This is a promise. If you live in a relationship with Jesus, God doesn't judge you by your old life. And so it doesn't give us a get out of jail free card of not dealing with our past. It just reminds us that God is more equipped to deal with your past than you are. And he makes all things new. And so maybe this week, rather than trying harder to overcome your past, maybe you just need to give up more. Maybe you're so tired from all of the effort that you're giving to relationships, and God's saying, hey, would you just lean into me? Would you stop trying to avoid getting in an argument with your wife and just pursue your wife? Would you stop trying to avoid making this mistake and just pursue me? Maybe you're just exhausted because you have convinced yourself that in order to be the person that God has in mind, in order to have the relationship that God has in mind, that you need to do more. And maybe God's saying, hey, would you just take a deep breath? Just be reminded of, yeah, you're not where you want to be. You're not where you used to be. And if you're in a relationship with me, I will transform you. I will make you new. I'll give you a new heart. I'll give you a new purpose. And I'll bring revitalization, and I'll bring purpose, and I'll bring healing, not only to your heart, but to the heart of your relationships.